Thanks for listening to the Drummer's Weekly Groovecast. You can contact the show at twitter.com/DW Groovecast and through Facebook at facebook.com/Drummer's Weekly Groovecast.
Good evening.
I am warning you right now, if you touch my drums, I will stab you in the neck with a knife.
Ain't a fucking. Ain't a fucking.
Mom!
Take it easy. Lower it.
I'm not going to lower it. I have to do this now.
I don't mind you playing it, but lower it.
Well, we get straight out?
No, we had a problem. I mean, we tried to do everything we could.
What do you mean?
Well, you know what I mean.
Nice!
Little trouble there. You're rushing.
Yeah, well, you know, that's just like your opinion, man.
Yeah!
Phil, I am in recovery mode in the biggest of ways for too many reasons.
Me too, actually. I'm still buzzing.
Good. That it by way of my instant messenger and text service, I'd say you're right in line with about 40 other people. So that's a good thing.
Tell these people what we're talking about.
We did an amazing show on Monday in tribute to Steve Gadd. And it was a lineup that was just beyond what I'd hoped it'd be. Had our typical setup in these tribute shows. We do five drummers and they play two or three songs each. And that night with the master that is Steve Gadd as the focus, we had some pretty brilliant stuff going down. Guys that played were Shannon Corey, who's actually part of our team too, and just gave him the opportunity to play, and he brought it, and then some. An amazing drummer that has taken Atlanta by storm in the last 5 or 6 years named Jack Jones. The legend that is Marlon Patton, about as well-rounded a cat as you're going to get, absolutely slayed on a three quartets tune, which is a tall order for anyone. And we had the amazing Little John Roberts back. He actually asked if he could play again, which completely freaks me out and blows my mind. And he took it to another level for sure. And closing it was the recent guest we had, Chris Fryer.
And from our new friend.
Our new friend. Yes. What an amazing cat. He is such a great and lovable guy. But Chris lives in Birmingham. He came over and blew us all away with his freaky good musicianship, a touch, a depth and facility and feel that was inspiring, man. Like, this guy is a true master. And I can't say enough about how those guys all absolutely killed it. And our house band was beyond all stars at every position.
Well, it's like I said when I walked in today, that the Porcaro show was a home run and this one was a grand slam.
Amazing.
And the attendance was amazing.
Yep.
As well. Just fantastic
attendance. Thank you.
And then the other thing that I want to add about the entire thing that I thought about it before I came over here today was that the show was roughly about, what do you say, an hour and 50 minutes or so, something like that.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
I actually made the hang after the show about the same amount of time as the show's length was itself. So that'll let you know also about the atmosphere, which is what this whole thing is about.
Yeah, man. My whole vision with that was people coming together and not just, you know, we have a real close-knit kind of circle of friends that, you know, not just drummers, but guys we work with and, you know, more than loosely connected. And it's a given they're going to show up, but there were cats from all kinds of circles there. And just, I mean, Eric Vaughn was there. And many of you maybe not know, but Eric is a legend in these parts. It's, you know, fantastic jazz drummer. And he was sitting right up front and locked in. And that kind of gives you a really great kind of idea of the breadth and the just diverse crowd we had. It was amazing. And everybody hung out.
Another person that I absolutely want to throw a massive shout out to that is another Atlanta legend that I hadn't seen in conservatively 15 years. Marcus Williams was there.
Man.
And I hugged that guy for 2 minutes straight, man. I hadn't seen him. It's been at least 15 years since I've seen him.
$1 million smile and a whole lot of love for drums and music, and he was an exceptionally cool person to see walk in the door. And I might add, within 5 minutes of him sitting down, he wins a brick of Vic First Sticks as a Vader endorser.
Man, don't blow his cover, man.
I had to give him some grief on that. So, you know, if any of y'all are listening, he's an honest guy. He's probably got him up on eBay right now. Don't worry.
I have a few observations that I want to, I even made notes to talk about this. One thing that cannot go unnoticed is that my faithful co-host across the table here was severely injured the night of the show. And I'm not, I mean, I'm being 100% serious. I'm talking about physically injured. He had a massively gimpy ankle in line with the great spider from Goodfellas being shot in the foot. I almost wanted to say, I saw you walking around, I'm like, no, I'm okay, spider. I thought you said I'm okay. Man, you were so pitiful, man, but you made it happen, dude.
Pitiful is right.
It should not have gone unnoticed that you were struggling the whole night. And another thing, I want to throw another massive shout out.
Thank you.
Yes,
I mean, I appreciate that. It was a challenge for sure.
We gave a shout out to some other people. I want to give a shout out to the listeners of this here show also, because we challenged everyone not only to come out, but to come out and say hi. You know, make sure that if we don't know you, or if we haven't met, hadn't seen each other in a long time, if we're just social media friends, come up and say hi. At least half a dozen people came up.
Love it.
And it was like, man, I just wanted to come up and say hi. I'm like, dude, thank you very much. Thank you very much. And of course, moving forward, John and I are going to be at all these shows. Come up and say hi to us again. We love it. We love it. We love it. The Chris Fryer in-person hang, priceless.
Epic.
You and I, you met me at the door. We walked in. Immediately, you said, hey, man, there's Chris. Sat down. Talked at least 45 minutes with him. Talked about just everything under the sun. It could have, of course, we talked SEC football. It's fantastic. We talked baseball, all that good stuff. It was great.
I had to remind Phil there was a music show that was going to happen.
Yeah. And then the last thing, and this is one of those things that I can't remember if it was our buddy Wayne Vire that said this to me, or might have been one of the infamous Banks brothers that was there, or it was somebody that was in between when we were in between drummers. And
why is this guy rambling on? Get him off the stage.
No, it wasn't
what
that.
An idiot.
Somebody came up to me, and it was one of those things. Now I'm going to, I used a Goodfellas reference. Now I'm going to use an Apocalypse Now reference. I'm going to use a reference from the inimitable Colonel Kurtz. So
they like the light show, you're saying?
They like the light
colors.
Show. The
horror.
The person
of this MC
said
the
this
horror.
To me. He said, and it hit me like a diamond bullet. In reference to Steve Gadd. And in reference to Steve Gadd's playing on all of these many different genres of music, whether it be jazz, pop, rock, singer-songwriter stuff, and it just hit me. It was so right. You know it's Gadd playing. You can tell it doesn't take any more than 8 bars when you hear Gadd playing, because you can hear underneath everything this guy plays, the absolute mastery of the fundamentals and that rudimental thing that he's got going.
Mm-hmm.
And man, he wasn't even talking about that prototypical paradiddle double stroke stuff. But man, just even in the swing stuff, man, you can hear that grid of that mastery of that fundamentals that's underneath it. And I was just like, dude, that might be one of the best, one of the most straight to the point, perfect, I guess you would call
observations.
It observations, man, of that's what makes that guy special, man.
It's true. There's a, you know, I listen to a lot of this music, you know, coming up to the show, and I was reminded of just when I was young, and I kind of fancied myself a jazz musician. I'll never play anything but straight ahead jazz. It's easy to say when you live at home. You know, I'm not going to play anything but straight ahead jazz. Yeah. And now I'll go eat my mom's meal that she fixed me and sleep in the bed she provided me. But Gadd was one of the first guys that kind of turned me around in that, you know, well-rounded and having a voice, having a sound, having a, you know, a musicality that you don't, you know, this is music. It's not jazz. It's not... This guy's just bringing it no matter what. And it really kind of turned my head around. And I really started exploring a lot more stuff. And I wish I could thank him personally for that, because now I'm just an old groove pig that can't play a double stroke roll. So he made me lazy, man. That's what I'm telling you.
Well, it was an absolute phenomenal night. There's going to be more of them in the future, of which you will hear about here and on our social media. This podcast and those tribute shows are the perfect hand-in-glove combination. So we appreciate everybody. We appreciate the listeners coming out to the show, and you will be hearing more.
Awesome. Thanks, everyone, for coming out. And there's a lot of great video online, YouTube.
A lot of great pictures.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, if you go to YouTube and type in Unknown Vincent, he's an amazing part of our music community here, out just about every night, recording great video and taking pictures and all that. But he's got just about every song we did posted. So check that out and thank him if you dig it. It was a magic night. We're going to have more. If you're in Atlanta, don't miss it.
You know, something that was absolutely missing from Monday night was the topic that we're going to talk about today. No imposters, no charlatans there, baby.
Not even remotely.
But this is a topic that we had a listener mention something about, you know, just in a list of things that they would like for us to cover. It was probably, God, a year ago when somebody sent something in and goes, if y'all are looking for something, maybe talk about imposter syndrome and anything that you guys might have encountered that made you have that imposter syndrome and what you did to get rid of it. Now, I think most people probably realize what it is, but I kind of crafted up a little musician's definition of what imposter syndrome is. And also, by the way, let me go ahead and say this also. There's another version of it, which is kind of the same thing. It's called charlatan syndrome. And most of the time, educators and pedagogues use charlatan syndrome because it sounds maybe a little cooler than imposter syndrome. But we'll call this imposter / charlatan syndrome. And my definition for it is the inability to recognize or minimize your accomplishments, thus creating the anxiety of being exposed as a fraud.
Man, that's not out of Webster's?
No, I made that one up.
What, did you go to school or something?
Well, that's where my first imposter syndrome comes in.
Ta-da!
So, you set me up, sir. So the first time, well, maybe not the first time, but one of the most vivid times that I can remember having a good, healthy dose of imposter syndrome is one where I think a lot of people will find common ground, because they probably have had this as well. And when I was an incoming freshman in undergraduate school, I was sort of the lucky man that dumbed himself into tripping over a pot of gold that I had no idea that the school that I was going to go to had one of the most revered educators in the history of jazz education under the name of Mr. Jerry Coker. And therefore, naturally, the staff that he's going to have underneath him and the student body that he's going to attract is going to be equally good. So I pretty much dumbed into a really, really good situation. And once I started telling some folks that I had dumbed into the situation, they made me aware of just how good of a situation that I had gotten myself into. So therefore, being somebody that didn't have a whole lot of proper training prior to that, sir, I had a good, healthy dose of imposter syndrome. And something that really created a lot of anxiety was the first day that I went up there for orientation and registration. And the orientation and registration that I had back in the late 80s is very different from what kids have now. Kids have this kind of orientation and registration that goes on for days, you know, in college. And I had probably about 2 hours of it. And that included being marched over to the music department and going into the building and sitting down with some advisor and them, you know, showing me what classes I needed to take, or at least what they thought that I needed to take, right? So to give
what
you...
What do they know?
Right, exactly. So again, to kind of set up, okay, where I'm at this as an 18-year-old kid, I'm from rural East Tennessee. I come from a very non-musical background. Also one of the first people in my family to go off to go to school. From the Scots-Irish background of Appalachian Hill people, which gives you that beautiful combination of lack of self-esteem and tons of buried rage. That's not a good combination.
And alcohol.
Yeah, you know? So you got a recipe for a massive imposter syndrome. So you take all that stuff and you head up to this school that has a good reputation, and you get in there for your orientation, and I'm surrounded by a table or a couple of tables of a bunch of kids that have 10 times my perceived pedigree, right? And there's always the cliques of kids that know each other, right? Because, man, they went through school with Allstate.
Mm-hmm.
They went to the summer camps. They knew each other, right? They had been in these different ensembles of these, you know, all-star kids. And the school that I went to barely had, the high school that I went to barely had a band program, much less any kind of a jazz band, much less any kind of a studio orchestra, anything like that, right? So, I mean, I was the proverbial, you know, the fish out of water. And, you know, they were always talking about, yeah, I've been working on this, and, you know, I've been taking theory lessons in the summer, and I've been, and anything that I had done one of two ways. I'd either done it on my own, right, teaching myself, literally buying theory books to work on, or I had had at least enough initiative. When I was about 17, I sought out my teacher, who was the teacher, the applied teacher up at the University of Tennessee, and he got me at least on the right path, right? So I got up there and was the fish out of water, didn't know anybody, surrounded by all these kids that knew everything. So I go in to register for my classes. We're all sitting there. Everybody's like, yeah, I've got to make sure I take this class, man. I got to make sure I do this. I knew nothing. I knew nothing. I knew that I had to take a theory class, you know. And so, you know, I'm sitting here with this person who's in, you know, advisement, that's probably used to advising also a bunch of, you know, legit orchestral kind of students. And they're like, well, you need to make sure you take, you know, this music history class. And so I'm kind of just hacking my way through all this stuff, thinking, man, I'm going to be lucky if I even make it, dude, to my first class, much less, you know, not knowing where I'm going, much less excel in it, because I'm sitting here with all these ringers that know what they're doing. And so I had set myself up mentally from the get-go to be behind the eight ball. And in some ways, I actually was behind the eight ball. I was playing catch-up, but I had a little more going for me than I thought I did, because I at least played well enough and could do enough that way to where my teacher helped me get into school. You know, in other words, I wasn't a complete and total hack. So the first class, man, that I ever had was an ear training and sight singing class. So I go into this thing, man, and I sit down and I have no idea what to expect. And it is a room full of eager beavers, baby. And this teacher sits down and he hands out a syllabus. And man, I didn't even know what a syllabus was. And he's going through it and he goes, well, let's just start out something kind of easy today. Let's start identifying some intervals. Dude, I didn't even know what intervals were. And man, these kids are going minor sixth, major second, perfect fifth, octave. And man, I'm just sitting there, I'm just going, okay, oh my God, right? So ultimately, I was sitting here watching these kids just completely and totally outperform me, and these professors were talking miles above my head. And essentially, the way that I got past this, and I did get past it, but it took a little while, is I literally had to expose myself, use that, as somebody's like, I'm just like, man, I'm already behind the eight ball. You know, I didn't have a band program that kind of nurtured this kind of talent. I didn't go to these summer camps. I don't really know anything about this kind of formal education. I told that to some teachers. I even told it to some students. And essentially what ended up happening was a couple things. One, I obviously told the right teachers, because man, they really backed me up. And they said, look, man, you know, you deserve to be here. And if you just work hard, if you need some help on this stuff, you gotta come to me. Don't sit back there and squander this thing away and, you know, end up dropping out or changing majors, because you got something. You wouldn't be here if you didn't have something, right? And so a combination of actually telling some of these people, students and teachers, and then also becoming an absolute obsessive psychopath when it came to working on this stuff was the cure for all of it. And then you're happy, glorious, riding off into the sunset on a white horse ending was, when I graduated on time. And of all those students that were there for registration, I was either A, the only person that didn't change their major, or I graduated. Some of the people did graduate as music majors, were behind me. So that's how I got out of that one.
Perseverance and hard work. Not afraid to own your shortcomings, you know, and having people investing in you. The perfect storm for
it was
your success.
That the perfect storm is an absolutely brilliant way.
Mm-hmm. And that's just like a nice spring rainstorm where everything smells good at the end.
Yeah.
So that's good. A great story and a reminder to everyone that sometimes we get so wrapped up in everyone else's pedigree and ability and, you know, the head start they've had that we just feel defeated. And it's just everybody's on their own time. You know, as parents, we've had to learn that the hard way. You know, you got the uber parent who's bragging about their kid, this and that, and blah, blah, blah. And you're thinking, like, what am I doing wrong? It's like, man, everyone has their time. and everyone has their pace. So to get terribly worked up about it, it's difficult in the moment for sure. But man, what I'm glad he persevered. It paid off.
I
mean, you're doing the same gigs I am, unfortunately. But
well, I felt like
that's where I get Joe when he gives me a hard time.
I felt like,
hey man, I graduated. I mean, yeah, well, we're both on this wedding, so whatever.
I felt like that I ended up cramming about 5 years of study and progress in about a year's period of time.
That's a pretty safe assessment if you're talking about graduating on time.
Yeah.
You had to catch up.
I did.
So, you know, when this was presented as a topic, the first thing that came to my mind was the absolute horrifying insecurity that most of us deal with on a regular basis, you know, like just everybody's better, I'm not worthy, I'm gonna. But the one thing that I laugh about with the scariest of musicians that I know, just the deepest, most burning cats, are like, man, I'm gonna be found out. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna be found out. And I have been living that nightmare forever. And what's really pathetic about that is, A, I'm never going to put myself in the position to, quote unquote, be found out, because I'm smarter than that. You know, hey, we're going to do a Frank Zappa tribute. I got some good numbers for you, man. You know what I mean? Like, you got to be realistic about it. But more importantly, man, I came up in that period where the legendary studio musicians were all the rage and all the focus and all of the influence. So there was these assholes who would continually talk about, you're going to be thrown to the wolves and you're going to have to read down some odd time Latin chart cold in front of a 60-piece orchestra with someone standing there looking at a watch as you do it, and blah, 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 and you're screwed from the word go. And this ridiculous little legendary scenario that probably happened twice in the freaking history of music, and they probably did a second take, is in your brain. And that pisses me off, because we all have been, especially people our age, have been just bullwhipped by that crap. And it just isn't realistic. So, you know, forever you're like, oh, I'm going to go to the studio and that's going to come down. Well, it's a singer-songwriter, John, record John. Just, you know, it's like a girl with an acoustic guitar. Yeah, but they'll probably call some, you know, odd time mambo with an extended drum solo. It's going to happen, right? No. It's not going to happen.
She's going to do the acoustic singer-songwriter version of Keep It Greasy.
Come on, man. But we this neurosis that is, no one back then, you know, that had your ear would talk about the 40 trillion times the Jeff Porcaro or the Earl Palmer or the, you know, Emil Richards and the legendary legit players went in and were yawning through some film score that was just as easy as it could be.
Yeah.
No, they're just talking about the nightmare scenario that happens once every 20 years. And that's something that I always, you know, as I'm older and wiser, I think, like, why would anybody tell somebody that? A young, unbridled kid with potential. Why would that's like saying, you know, if you walk in that backyard, there's 42 rattlesnakes. You know, like, why would you do that? Unless there's 42 rattlesnakes and you want to protect this kid, don't lie about it. You know, that's just you trying to look like you're in the know, and you're just putting the fear of God in others because you probably have it, is really what it boils down to.
That, and I think there's also some credence from the standpoint that some guys, if they really want to put the vibe in you, if they're in that world, sometimes they want to protect their gig just from the standpoint of like, listen, you know.
You
don't want to get involved in this mess.
That's a good point.
This is the kind of stuff I have to deal with.
Which is a lie. We could call any studio musician of note, and they would tell you 10% of the stuff they do is really, truly challenging them, perhaps above what they think their ability is. No, man. No one's calling me for that. They know what I do. I'm not getting called for fusion records.
Well, and this is where good old-fashioned experience trumps the day.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, like you said, going into the studio and getting a few sessions under your belt that you feel pretty good about and realizing that, yeah, you're talking about 1% of all studio sessions end up being in that vein. I mean, I've even done a couple of, like, we'll call them legit sessions where I've played some percussion on sessions, and they were not that difficult. So, yeah, I think that there's some good old-fashioned vibing going on.
Yeah, we create these mythical, unrealistic pictures of how you're going to be presented with things. And on top of that, look, if you really, honestly, if you were presented with a session of that ilk, of that level of challenge, of that level of ability, two things are already happening. One, you're getting called because you probably have the ability to do it, mm-hmm. and your reputation precedes you, but I guarantee you, you're getting stuff ahead of time. You're not sight reading it. No one's wasting that money, that time, or their reputation calling some guy to come in and sight read something. And in this day and age, especially digital format, you can do share anything without even, you know, getting out of your breakfast chair.
Yeah, so. The artist or producer of said session would be committing a type of professional suicide by not doing that.
Exactly.
Yeah.
No, nobody's wanting to commit professional suicide, so they're covering their butt.
That's a good one, man.
And I cover my butt by saying, that's not for me. I don't do that. That's just being, screw your ego. Be realistic about what you can do, and don't put yourself in that scenario.
That's like, I'm trying to think who it was that said that. It was like Porcaro telling one producer to call John Robinson because he played it better than him. Isn't that ridiculous?
Man, that's amazing.
Yeah.
You could do that when you make a gazillion dollars a week with the other 40 sessions you have booked.
That's true.
So anyway, that was the first thing that came to mind with imposter, like, oh, I'm going to be found out. And man, if I gave you a list of people that have told me that, it'd blow your mind.
Oh, I'm sure.
It's just, it's sad. It's real, and we need to do everything we can to keep the next generation from being handcuffed by that crap.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. And that is also the perfect segue to tell you about an elder that pulled me out of something. And it's a great name, man. It's a fantastic name.
Will you drop it on my right foot and not my left, please?
I will. I will do that.
I appreciate that.
After I graduated undergraduate school, I ended up getting an assistantship to go to graduate school over at University of Memphis. And by that time, I had a fair amount of bravado under my belt. I was leaving the big fish in a small pond, and I was going to be the small fish in the big pond. Because you move over there, there's some great players, and I'm going to really illustrate it here in just a minute. I hadn't been over there any more than about 3 or 4 months, and I was studying with a really super fine drummer that has since moved from Memphis. He is living in New Orleans. I still stay in touch with him. He plays in a band called the Iguanas. His name is Mr. Doug Garrison. Tremendous drummer, man. Really great player. And at that time, he was out on the road actually with Alex Chilton from the Box Tops, right? So he had a steady Sunday night jazz gig that was in a little club right downtown in Memphis called the North End. I think it's actually still there, that club. And I don't know that this jazz jam session still happens, but it was the place to be, man, on Sunday nights. The North End in Memphis. And so he had that as the house gig. And I would go down and sit in there. And then occasionally when he was out of town or couldn't do it, he would ask me if I would sub in on the gig, and I would do it. So I had maybe done that gig a couple of times, maybe two or three times, the first 3 or 4 months that I was there. So we get through the first semester, and he goes, "Hey, man, I am going to be out on the road during the holidays, and I want to see if you can do the homecoming gig." And I'm like, "Homecoming gig?" And he goes, "Yeah, the homecoming gig, man." And he goes, "You don't know about it?" And I said, "No." He goes, "Well, it's the same Sunday night, but it's this little traditional thing that they do where everybody that's in town, it's back home, they come down and everybody sits in. It's a big night, man. You'll have a blast." And I said, "Well, of course, I'll do it, man. I'll do this homecoming gig." So I was on board for that, right? And I started getting wind of what this homecoming gig is. And for you guys that are not aware of the deep, deep lineage of jazz musicians that come out of Memphis, I made a little list of some of the people that were there that night, not as the rhythm section, but were there to see what was going on and to come in and play. And to the best of my remembrance, this was who was there that night: James Williams, Mulgrew Miller, George Coleman, Harold Mayburn, Donald Brown, and Bill Mobley. Yeah, so if you had any one of those guys on a gig, you know it's pretty much a world-class gig, right? But all of those guys were there. Now, to my advantage, I did know Donald Brown because my junior year at Tennessee, he actually came on faculty there. So I did know him. And I had also known James Williams for a short period of time because A, Donald introduced me to him, and B, I had actually done a series of little gigs for NARS, the NARS, the Grammy folks. He had come into town to do something for like Grammy for the kids or Grammy for the students, and he hired a bunch of students, basically graduate students from Memphis, and we did some stuff with him. So I knew him there as well. So here we are. I'm new in town. I really very unproven. So I'm in this rhythm section with a bunch of dudes in Memphis that are also kind of they're also these little bit of standoffish guys, little bit snarky guys, so you never really know where you stand with them, right? So you got that happening as well. And throughout the night, man, I am watching Harold Mayburn walk in. I'm watching George Coleman walk in with a floor-length leather coat, right? I mean, this is exactly what you think it's going to be. And these guys are, you know, he's carrying a saxophone, so you know he's going to play, right? So we're on this set. George Coleman walks up with his saxophone. And let me go ahead and say this also. Let me tell you who was sitting in on bass on this, because he and I still talk about this. I haven't talked to him in years, but he and I still talk about this. Remember Rodney Jordan? Rodney was sitting in on bass because he's originally from Memphis also, but he was in graduate school at Jackson State when I was in graduate school at Memphis, right? But he would come up and we would play together. And since then, you know, we reconnected in Atlanta and played. So anyway, we still would talk about this from time to time. But George Coleman comes in and he sits in on saxophone, and he does one of those things where we play a tune and he turns around to the rhythm section. And this doesn't mean anything to me, but it certainly does to everybody else. He starts modulating these tunes, and everybody's got to try to keep up with him. So we went through this, right? Played. He stops playing. Somebody else plays, like a guitar player is playing a solo. He shoos away the piano player. George sits down and starts playing piano. And I'm not talking about he's not just kind of halfway playing. I'm telling you, man, this guy's playing better than the piano player was playing. comes around, he plays solos on piano, right? Bill Mobley comes up, plays just a ripping trumpet solo, right? So this thing goes on. We take a break. James Williams is sitting up at the bar up there with like Harold Mayburn and some and Donald. And so, man, I go up there and they saw, man, that I was pie-eyed, right? And there was probably, man, I would say there was 250 people in the room. There was no place to sit down. The most comfortable place in the entire building was on the bandstand, right? Because it was just, everybody was right up on you everywhere you went. So I go up there and, you know, James and Donald's up there. And I was just like, man, I am hanging on for dear life. It's something like that was what I said. And what James said to me at that time was, he goes, man, in situations like this, we're all hanging on for dear life. And then he kind of joked around. He goes, well, except for maybe George. And then everybody just kind of laughed. And I was just, and man, that did it. I was just like, this guy is gold.
That is beautiful.
Absolute beautiful. Gold, man.
Yeah. Wow. That, man, what a turn of events in seconds.
Yeah.
I might put a gun in my mouth. No. Here's a hot dog.
Yeah, exactly. And
that was terrible, but well, I mean, man. That no, here's a cocktail, whatever.
Yeah, that goes right along with I expose myself to all the other students, right? That guy, man, he could tell that I was about to freaking lose my mind, man. You know, because I had never met George Coleman before. Mm-hmm. And I mean, everybody knows the guy's beyond a legend. And mm-hmm. he comes in and plays literally for 10 minutes worth of solos while me and Rodney are hanging on for dear life during this entire thing.
Crazy.
And so, yeah, and boy, likewise, let me tell you this. I had done a few gigs with James, and I actually had played with him a few times after that as well. And that was one guy when he passed away. Man, boy, that, because I had not really stayed that in close touch with him, because that happened. He died about 12 years after all this stuff happened. He's been dead about 14, 15 years now. But boy, that really affected me when he died, because, man, there's nobody as good as that guy. And again, another world-class player that was criminally underrated, in my opinion, as well.
I agree.
So there's a great example, man, of a elder statesman, man, that really grabbed a youngster, picked him up by the back of the, you know, the scruff of the neck and said, you're going to be just fine, sir. You're in the position that we've all been in.
I love that story. You know, we get into that, the whole jazz realm of things, and I feel like an imposter, like, to the 10th power in that setting. But here's a weird thing about it. In the same week, I went to a jam session on a Tuesday. And my friend was playing, and you gonna play? No, I don't want to play. I had a couple drinks, blah 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 blah, you know. And then they like literally were like called me up, and like nothing was going to happen until I came up. You know, I'm like, no. Well, we'll just sit here and wait. And I'm just like, oh. I went up there, and I felt it was miserable. It wasn't my drums. It wasn't my, you know, I have a little buzz. I'm like, oh, I just feel like. There's a couple arm crossers in the audience that I knew who they were, and they're just like, whatever. And it was miserable. It was miserable. It played awful, I think, you know. And everything. 2 days later, I'm on a gig with two of the absolute best jazz musicians in this town and feel effortless and feel completely at ease, because they're really close friends of mine, and they're both these incredibly inviting and comforting spirits as people. I just feel like I'm balancing these two things out. You know, I went from Tuesday night feeling like the absolute loser to Thursday night feeling like, man, everything's cool. I, you know, I know what I can do. I know what I can't do. So there is a, there's this mythical thing that we create in our heads as drummers. And it's probably with every instrument, but if you're not a jazz musician, you're thinking, man, if I don't play like Tony Williams or Elvin, yeah, the world's going to end. And I, you know, should I try to do it? Should I not? Blah, 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 blah. It's like, first and foremost, no, you shouldn't. Secondly, make it feel good. You know, that's what you have in your arsenal. Then you need to lean on that. And I wrestled with that for a long time. Like, I wouldn't go to jam sessions because I didn't play like Tony Williams. I wouldn't, you know, accept gigs because I didn't play like Elvin Jones. And a really, really fantastic jazz drummer in town who's a close friend of mine who I love dearly and I love his playing dearly. He said something to me a while ago, and he's talking about gigs, and he goes, man, you know, at the end of the day, and as I get older, man, I just want to dig a trench. And I was like, oh, it hit me like a Mack truck. And I played a gig not too long ago with some really heady players, and it was like, that's all I did. I just thought about that phrase, like, man, I'm just going to dig a trench, because, man, that's what I do. Mm-hmm. And when it's group playing or if it's jazz playing, it's like just trying to make it feel good and keep time and just lay down that foundation. And I called him and I thanked him about it. I said, man, I've wrestled for years with this imposter thing about not being able to play like Tony Williams. And he's like, oh, man, this is a guy who can play like that.
Mm-hmm.
And he's just like, man, whatever, man. And most people don't want to hear that crap anyway. You know, and he's just like, he just said, you got to go with what you got and make it work, and you have to believe in yourself in that setting. Like, hey, I know my limitations, but I'm gonna make music. And it was something that I've really gotten past in the last couple of years actually. We have these lofty standards. Well, Tony Williams, first and foremost, is an alien. Second, he lived and breathed bebop. Thirdly, he played with the absolute best musicians on the planet every day. So my two jazz gigs a year, I'm supposed to play like that? I mean, come on, man. We got to be realistic about this stuff. And that's how I got past it was, an absolute beast of a friend said, man, just dig a trench, bro.
I love it, man.
It was incredible.
There's way too many times that we as drummers that forget, first and foremost, above everything else, regardless of the style of music that you are playing, we are accompanists.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of times we vibe ourselves out from the standpoint of when we get thrust into a situation that we know lends itself to being a more improvisational or soloistic style of music that we superimpose, that it's got to be that way, and it doesn't have to be that way. You can choose for it to be that way, but you can't tell me that all of these greats that we always talk about, like Jack and Tony, and not every gig can be a home run, not even for them.
No doubt.
So that's great advice, man. I love that dig a trench.
Incredible, man. It turned my head completely around because I'm thinking like, man, I could do that. You know, I'm not going to be able to play heady solos for 72 bars, but I could be a foundation for this amazing sax player where he is free to do whatever the hell he wants to do without any distraction or any one-upmanship, you know. And, you know, I come to find out, when I was younger, I played in St. Louis, I played with some pretty heavy name, recognizable names, and I kept always would wonder, like, why are they hiring me? Because I'd play some trio gigs here and there, and the settings were usually like, you know, you got to be background, you know, that kind of thing. It was never like showcase gigs, but mm-hmm. I finally asked this bass player, legend, I'm like, and why am I in this gig? And he goes, man, because you just play simple, and we can play all this insane crap over it, and everybody thinks it's just this pleasant little piano trio because you're just sitting back there grooving.
Staying home, man. And stay home. Like, let those guys venture out.
And,
yeah.
And he said, "We there's a number of people that would come on this gig and couldn't help themselves but to go with us. And that just can't happen under certain circumstances." And I was just like, wow, cool, okay. So, you know, be careful what you wish for. Be careful what your expectations can be. You know, in that particular case, I was hired to be nothing but a guy swinging with some brushes in the background,
mm-hmm.
you know, and I traded fours twice in one night, in the night at max. So there you have it. You know, we just build up this stuff in our head, and this imposter syndrome is what it truly is. That's the perfect definition for it. I'm going to get found out. But oftentimes we will take the pressure we built in ourselves and in our brain and go where we shouldn't. Oh, I got to play headier. I got to play more interactive. I got to have a, well, man, maybe that's not appropriate. But because of the people on the bill, you feel you have to do that? Screw that. Look at the gig, not the people on the bill. What is appropriate for the gig? If people are sitting around drinking mm-hmm. martinis and catching up, you can't play like the most burning freeform jazz drummer on the planet. It just don't. So that, you know, we got to get out of our own way with expectations. So that's the other part of that story is it doesn't matter who's on the gig, man. Know the gig.
Good stories, man. And great endings, more importantly.
Yeah, we kind of messed up a couple endings because I didn't know the head. But they forget. Oh, you were talking about,
you know,
something else, right?
It came to a pleasant resolution is all I'm saying. In other words,
it ended.
that it did. So
nobody died. That was the other criteria.
John, let's finish up the show today with what is turning out to be one of our most popular segments.
Oh, I don't know about that.
Oh, no, it is. One of the emails we received last week was from a listener named Steve. And Steve, we will keep your last name anonymous.
By the way, Steve, yes. And I go way back, even though he might not know it.
Okay.
He has been a insanely longtime member of the Drum Forum.
Okay, gotcha.
Back to the Harry days.
Got ya. So,
and
yeah.
As of I. And he might have even been on RMMP, but I'm not positive of that. But we're talking
the days of dial-up internet.
Correct me if I'm wrong, Steve, with an email or what have you, but I think it was Harry's forum that I first saw his name. And just wanted to say hi and thanks for the feedback.
Yeah.
Old friend.
Yeah, essentially, Steve emailed us last week and was singing the praises of John's call for the Evapo Rust. He had acquired an older kit that had some problems with the hardware. The Evapo Rust saved him a ton of headache. So, right awesome. On. We love that kind of feedback. So, without any further ado,
this one actually gives you more low end torque and more high end horsepower. That way, you can go down the track at 350 miles per hour.
Drummer's Weekly Groovecast Garage.
John, what have you got for us in this edition?
Well, I came very prepared for this,
love
as
it.
You know.
Love it.
That's not true. But fortunately, a pal of mine needed some Gretsch lugs, and I kind of saved the day. And I thought, this is a little more specific and a little more brand-centric and all that, but it has been the bane of many a restorer's existence for a number of years. Gretsch uses these horrific pot metal bolts, and they're self-tapping on top of that, which is just a nightmare of a combination. And I believe they've since improved the quality of those, but through the 60s, 70s, and 80s, especially the 70s and 80s, we were talking piss poor quality bolts that, mm-hmm. you know, that you pray your lug disc can stay on the drum. But unfortunately, you know, damaged shells or rewrapped stuff, things you get in, you got to remove these lugs. And inevitably, some snap off in there and they're useless. But you oftentimes, with the self-tapping and the cheap metal, you're pulling them out and they just pretty much, the bolts themselves especially, just fail. So when you're trying to put it back on, these threads are torn up or flattened or just damaged to the point where they can't grab the threads that they originally created in mm-hmm. the nipple of the lug mm-hmm. that comes through and you where the hole with the threads are. So we were talking some solutions, and one is, and I'm just going to point out what you had said, unless you want to get some credit for
no,
that.
No, you go for it.
Phil said the best thing to do to try to avoid, which you more than likely, if you're taking 20 lugs off a drum, you're not going to avoid the problem of these stripped bolts. I even feel like I'm insulting bolts by calling them bolts. This molten shape of a bolt
that weighs a 0.25 of a gram
on a good day.
Yeah.
So, you know, the first thing to do is, if you're pulling them out, you've got to be real careful. It's a feel thing. Use a nut driver, pull it out slowly. It's probably going to feel weird. And that's the nature of a self-tapping bolt. But if you get it out and it looks okay, do yourself the biggest favor. Make sure that exact bolt goes back in that exact hole. And there's a chance it'll work. If you just throw that bolt in a little coffee can and try to throw it back on, you're probably going to run into problems. Mm-hmm. Some of them might work. A lot of them won't. So that's number one. Go the extra mile and lay that stuff out on a, you know, nice white blanket or towel or something, and have them where they're just undeniably mm-hmm. locked into the same hole. If in fact you have ones that fail, there's some good replacement bolts you can get. You can even get the hexed ones. You can get them flat, you can get them with a little ridge around the mm-hmm. hex. You know, go online and look. You want to get 8/32 thread with a 3/8 inch length is typically the best length for accommodating either small or large.
That is golden information right there. Say that one more time. Say the exact.
This is a hex bolt with an 8/32 inch or 8/32 thread, mm-hmm. and you want it to be 3/8 of an inch. That will accommodate both lugs typically. If you run into them, you need a shorter one on occasion. If you have a very thin shell on a smaller mounted tom, every once in a while they can bottom out. The 80s drums, not so much. 70s, some of those shells were a little thinner, mm-hmm. and that small amount can make a difference with the 3/8 inch length. So on top of that, what you're going to need to do is buy a little T-tap wrench. It's a simple little T-shaped thing that a tap tap, what's the word to use? It kind of looks almost like a drill bit. It's mm-hmm. a tap bit. It mm-hmm. goes in, you tighten it down, and you gently tap each hole out, clean it out, blow it out, get it real clean. You've created a thread that's going to accommodate the new bolts. And you can use the existing flat washers. You probably want to get some number 8. I like the flat kind of the sun looking.
I know what you're talking about. Yes.
I should be better prepared in my description, but they're a flat lock washer mm-hmm. that's not where the one end comes over the other, but it's more of this
star-looking pattern. Thing. Yeah
star uh-huh. pattern. That's uh-huh. great. Instead of that, you could use the traditional folded over, but I think that the other one's kind of work better with getting everything clean and the thread going in deep enough, pardon me, to do that. So, and at that point, you'll have zero trouble putting the lug on and it staying on. But again, like I said, a little more brand specific, and but man, if I had a dollar for everyone who asks, like, I hate these, what can I do, blah, 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 mm-hmm. there's your solution.
And then the one thing that I will add to the end of that is whatever you do, do not over-tighten.
No. Nothing good's coming out of that.
Yeah.
Firm, but not, we have the propensity to think we have to just crank it. This isn't a car. It's not a wheel.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's not going to fall off and kill you. So just make it snug, make it where it's not rattling, and let that lock washer do some work. But yeah, if you get too heavy, you break it right off into that lug.
Love
not, not if you're doing the replacement bolts. I typically use stainless steel, and they seem to be pretty good. But nonetheless, there you go.
This advice is going to bear fruit to our listeners, 100%. I'll guarantee you somebody, we will get another email about this one, because this is a good one. Excellent one. Great job, sir.
Thank you.
Before we get out of here, I want to also acknowledge another one of our listeners that got to us about a week or so ago. One of our friends named Bill that lives here in town made me aware that we lost someone in our educational community, John. We lost Marvin Dahlgren, and most drum set players are going to know him from a really famous book that he wrote called Four-Way Coordination. It's one of those books that rank up there with a lot of the other great Bibles of drumming, with like the Chapin book, the Syncopation book. It's from that kind of that same vintage, that same era. I think it's a 1940s or 50s book. But Marvin Dahlgren passed away this last week. He was the longtime percussionist for the Minneapolis Symphony Orchestra, and he was a teacher at one of the universities up there. I think it might have been University of Minnesota itself that he was a teacher. So that's going to do it for this week, guys. All I want to do now is say, make sure you visit our website. We're at drummersweeklygroovecast.com. It's our aggregation of everything DWG. You got every episode there. You got all of our videos there. You can subscribe to our social media, manage your subscriptions to the show. You can always reach out to us. We've been getting emails through our contact form that way. So head over to drummersweeklygroovecast.com. And then one thing I would like to ask everyone, we don't ever ask you guys for money. We don't really ask you guys to do anything very often. But one thing that would help us out that would be really nice is share the show. When you see us post something on social media, of course, we're at Instagram, we're at Twitter, we're at Facebook, and just even our website. If you have some friends that you think would this show would benefit, musicians, drummers, just share the show. It really helps us out. The show's still growing. John and I were talking about it today. It seems like every few months we get a new little burst of energy, and a host of new folks come on board. So if you could share the show, that would be great. Good show, John.
Yeah. Hey, addressing listeners, I can never say it enough, but I know I speak for Phil when I genuinely say we appreciate you guys listening and participating, and we don't take it for granted. You know, we certainly don't think we know it all. Come on board and participate in any way, shape, or form you can. I love the discussion, but thanks so much for listening. It's a pleasure to just do this every week with something we're passionate about, and hopefully it's resonating with you. And again, like Phil said, share with others that you think it might resonate with as well.
All right, guys, that's going to do it for this week. We'll see you next Monday. Bye-bye.
Thank you.